did you know it's your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know it's your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know it's your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? Your baby boy would one day rule the nations. Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great you know.
Please join me in the call to worship. November ends, December begins.
We find our beginning and our ending in God.
Month after month, our God attends us and supports us. For God's company, we offer thanks and praise. Let us worship the God who gives us Jesus Christ. God, who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the living one and our Redeemer, now and forever.
Let us pray. God, we thank you for this place and this time again, how the Sundays roll around and it is such a joy to be in your house. God, help us with whatever is going on in our minds as the season gets busier and busier. Help us to just clear all of that away. Help us to put you first, not just today, but all days. Help us to understand that each day is not ordinary. Each day that we have with you is extraordinary. Come, let us adore you in your Son's name. Amen. Please be seated. Do we have birthdays or anniversaries today? I'm going to come down here. All right, beautiful. You could just see right there. There you go. No, you don't. But I'm here if you need me.
Yeah.
Pardon me. Ann needs. There you go. She says that you need a bigger church.
I can't hear either.
All right, we're going to let you go first. 25. She's got some quarters here. 50. 75. No more quarters, guys. 80. 81. 82, 83, 84, 85, 86. Oh, that's your birthday. Wonderful. So is your birthday today? Okay. Happy birthday on Friday. And you're going to do amazing things on Friday.
I am.
You're going to go out dancing?
No, but I am. No, I'm
not. Oh. Yeah, so Bill's service is on Friday at, it's 10 a.m., right? 10 a.m. at the Gridley Seventh-day Adventist on Indiana. And what Ann is saying is she gets to go to his service on her birthday. And I think that's amazing, a celebration of your birth and a celebration of his new life in heaven. That's wonderful. Nice. All right, and if you guys didn't come out, I was going to come up. I was just going to out you because I already knew. All right, what do we have? Okay, 5, 10, 15, 20, 21. Congratulations. Nice. And I saw on Facebook a beautiful tribute to your husband. That was wonderful. I didn't see one for you, but... But I'm sure you gave it in person, and it was beautiful. Yeah. All right, so let's celebrate together. The wrong direction, didn't I? Do you need help or you got it?
We have gathered today to light the second candle on our Advent wreath, but before we do, let's relight the other candles and be reminded of the message from it. We relight the first candle to remember that Advent is a time of preparation. During these days, we are getting our hearts ready for the coming of the Christ child. We are remembering our hope that Jesus would come to earth to tell us of God's love, the candle of hope.
on my glasses. I'm like, whoa. On this second Advent candle we light today represents joy. We look back with joy that God would come into the world, and we would look forward to his return, expecting the great joy that he has promised us. What do you do to bring someone joy? Am I supposed to wait for an answer? I didn't get to check in. I think you get to just think about it. Share something that happened this week that made you feel joy. And what gift could you give to Jesus to make him joyful? Remember, all of the joy that you have in your life is because of the birth of Jesus Christ, and thank him.
Thank you.
That's cool. That's a scavenger hunt. That's cool. Very cool. Okay. We don't have to talk about that. Let's not talk about that. Okay? So, anyway. You were great, but you hit exactly what we're supposed to think about. Come here, Jackson. Exactly what you guys are supposed to think about for Christmas. Because all the things make us think of Christmas, but there's a main thing we need to remember about Christmas, and that's what? Jesus, right? And who was born at Christmas, Jackson? Jesus, baby Jesus. Good job, right? So it's fine to think of all the other things, because I love everything about Christmas. I love all of it, but you got to remember what's really important, okay? All right? So I have for you guys this little, it's a craft, and it's the nativity scene, okay? And you can put it up around your house so you can remember. So there's baby Jesus, and then there's Mary and Joseph, and here's the shepherds, and here's the wise men, and here's an angel, and a camel, and a donkey, because that's where they were. They didn't have cars back then, so they had to ride on the donkey, okay? And then the baby had to be born kind of in a barn like that, and with hay and stuff, because there was no room for him. All right? So I'm going to give each of you guys one of these, and you can make these and put it around your house so you can remember what Christmas is really about, the most important thing. It's about lots of things, but the most important thing, okay?
Okay.
All right, let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for these beautiful children. Let them remember what Christmas is truly about, and let's enjoy the season, everything it has to offer, but number one is Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Before you go, do you have prayers you want to include for our joys and concerns? No?
No, we're good.
So, Jackson, are you done with your little snack up here? Are you going to move to Sunday school?
Come on, get up.
As I was watching and listening, I was thinking, we need your kids here every week. Because they are adorable, and every week is different, and we enjoy it. Yeah. Every week is a new Sunday.
And I tell her, don't be.
No, exactly. Yeah. Family.
Absolutely.
I am going to, before we start our joys and concerns, I want you to ponder something, and then I want you to get back to me. So I'm not going to out anyone, but I have this quandary going on for Christmas Day. Christmas Day is a Sunday. I have absolutely no problem having service at 9 o'clock on Christmas Day. We're also having Christmas Eve at noon on Christmas Eve. So noon Christmas Eve here. Christmas Day, I can do a 9 a.m. here. And here's what my concern is. My concern is that everybody will be with their families at 9 a.m. in their pajamas and not be here, and then miss the service. What I can do and am willing to do is put a recorded Christmas service up so that you can watch it anytime you want on Christmas Day. I will make sure that I'll do it ahead of time so that it can land on Christmas Day early, and you can watch it anytime during Christmas Day. So I also don't want the added pressure for you guys of feeling like you have just one more thing. But the other side of it is, I want you, if you guys want a service, because it's Christmas Day, Jesus Day, I don't want to close down your opportunity. So I'm really looking for feedback from you. And you can text message me, you can email me, you can call me. give me some feedback, because if you don't give me feedback, I'm going to make my decision one way or the other, and it may not be a decision that the majority wants. I'm trying to do the majority, but if I don't know what the majority is, I easily can fumble that ball, okay? So please let me know, and I'm going to keep that in prayer. And one way or the other, the decision doesn't mean you're putting one thing over another. The decision doesn't mean that you're putting your family ahead of God. I'm not going to think one way or the other. I'm not going to think less of anyone. I just want to be able to honor our Christ child and to honor your families at the same time. So I'm keeping that in prayer, and I ask you to join me in prayer. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. All right, others? Heavenly Father, we lift up each and every prayer to you, the prayers that are heavy on our hearts, the praises, the prayers of thanks, no matter what is going on. God, we pray for those that are not here. We pray for those that are ill. We pray for those that have so much going on, and there is so much in our hearts that has yet been mentioned, and we lift those prayers up as well. Let us come together now in the prayer that your Son taught others, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Ron, I'm going to ask you to come on up and play some music as we continue in offering back to God our tithes and offerings. And I need a couple of ushers, please. please come forward. Thank you both. Beautiful. Thank you. Would you stand as you're able for the doxology? God, we thank you for the gifts that you bless us with, and then we can return and watch how you magnify it and multiply it for your glory. God, we thank you for all that you do for us, for those that you're reaching, for us to be a part of who you are reaching. In your
so today's name. Reading comes Amen. From Luke 2, 8 through 20. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby. It was night, and they were taking care of their sheep. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news. It will bring great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Here is how you will know I am telling you the truth. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth lying in a manger." Suddenly, a large group of angels from heaven also appeared. They were praising God. They said, "May glory be given to God in the highest heaven, and may peace be given to those he is pleased with on earth." The angels left and went into heaven. Then the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby. The baby was lying in the manger. After the shepherds had seen him, they told everyone. They reported what the angel had said about this child. All who heard it were amazed what the shepherds said to them. But Mary kept all these things like a secret treasure in her heart. She thought about them over and over. The shepherds returned. They gave glory and praise to God. Everything they had seen and heard was just as they had been told. These are the words of our Lord.
We are talking today about the shepherds. Last week, we started our great adventure in the time where Joseph and Mary come together and they have this beautiful child, and the shepherds are now coming into the story when the angels talk to the shepherds and they go and see who this child is. This child that was born in a barn behind the inn in Bethlehem. These shepherds, they were shepherds that were living in the fields nearby, according to scripture, when the Christ child was born. Shepherds, they were going about their job, ordinary stuff, right down to taking care of the sheep, tending to them night and day. And in the neighborhood, a child is born. This amazing child. And I wonder if they would have even known, but for a message from God, would they have known about the Christ child that was born right down the street? This ordinary life with ordinary people. We saw it with Joseph and Mary. We see it with the shepherds until God intervenes and it becomes extraordinary. These ordinary people, the shepherds, they were the first visitors for the king, for the Christ child. There is some ambiguity over the shepherds. So they could have been the shepherds that were watching the temple sheep. The temple sheep were closer in to Bethlehem, and they were used for a specific purpose. They were used for the Passover each year. And so the shepherds, well, I want you to hear the word shepherds. They may have been, I don't know, a step up from the normal shepherds, but I also want you to hear a shepherd is a shepherd, and a shepherd gets dirty because they're with sheep. Now, we don't know for sure if they were the temple sheep that the shepherds were watching. They could have been ordinary shepherds, and they just happened to have their sheep that were close and in the fields near Bethlehem. Regardless of whether or not they were temple sheep or not, the shepherds had this difficult and dirty job. Contact daily with dirty, smelly sheep. They were around the manure. They were stepping in probably mud puddles and dirt and maybe even manure, not with boots, but with sandals. They dealt with animal blood from cuts, from scrapes, from the birth of lambs. They were in the field with bugs and insects, and I'm guessing they didn't have any bug repellent, so that means that they have these bug bites that are scratchy and itchy, and probably they had rashes at times, not to mention sunburn. I don't know what their skin looked like, but it probably was a bit of a mess, and the winter had its all new challenges, I'm sure. The shepherds could wash in the creek or in the pond, but did they really get the dirt under their fingernails or under their toenails? Were they really able to get clean like you and I would think? And they certainly were isolated to an extent. They weren't living in town. They weren't allowed to worship with people in town. And I even wonder if they had children and wives and children. I guess the wives come first. I wonder if they have relationships with anyone other than friendships with those that are out in the field with them. Maybe relationship was a luxury that didn't happen often. I do think there were some benefits of being a shepherd, living off of the land, not many people telling them what to do, giving them orders, a beautiful opportunity to look up at the stars at night, pondering who God was. I think they had more devotion and relationship time with God than most. They probably had satisfaction with being stewards over the land, caring for it and the animals that were placed in their care, this sense of freedom that many of us would enjoy. But it was also a dangerous job, and it was a job that took a lot of creative thinking. Thought went into how to care well for the sheep, knowledge was needed for when they needed to move them to a new pasture, and what pasture would it be? Innovation was needed for how to protect the sheep from predators, learning how to care for the sheep when they got injured, learning how to care for each other, or if they were just by themselves, they were the only shepherd, how do they care for themselves when they get injured? Caring for everything around them and always relying on God, because that's who they had to rely on. Now, we don't know how many shepherds were in the fields at this particular time, but Scripture tells us it was definitely more than one and probably more than two. They were leading their ordinary lives. They were watching. They were listening. They were aware of their surroundings. They were knowing the land, knowing the behavior of the sheep, knowing the behavior of the animals who were coming after the sheep. It was just this ordinary day. But on the day that the angel appeared, the angel of the Lord, a day that started out ordinary became extraordinary. They received this extraordinary birth announcement, not by email or by text or by phone or by social media, but by an angel. We think of December and Christmas often as the last days of the year, the ordinary days. They're busy. I heard from a lot of you this morning about we are busy with having illness in our house. We are busy with the hustle and bustle of getting ready for Christmas. We are busy with a whole bunch of things, but nobody said I had an extraordinary day that I have to tell you about. We say we had busy days, but not extraordinary. We are living in the extraordinary days. The extraordinary days because God is present with us. That's what makes our days extraordinary. These days are extraordinary. Advent and Christmas is the beginning, not the end. We like to see December as the end of the year. This is the beginning for Christians. Advent is the beginning time of when Christ is born, the beginning for Jesus, the beginning for Joseph and Mary and the shepherds and everybody else in the story, and we are in God's story as well. It is the beginning for us. It's the beginning of the great adventure. The beginning of the adventure when the angels appeared. Not for the first time, by the way, in Luke. In Luke, there are other times that angels had appeared. For the first was Gabriel, who spoke to Zechariah, telling of the son that would be born. That would be John the Baptist. And then Gabriel spoke to Mary about her son to come. An angel appeared to Joseph as well. And now an angel, and then many angels after this one, appear to the shepherds. The angels are messengers of God, and the shepherds knew this. Scripture gives us evidence to understand that they knew that these angels, the first one and then a group of them, were coming with a message for them from God. Scripture initially says that there's this one angel that appears to the shepherds. The glory of the Lord was around them. Scripture says in the way it was around them, meaning the glory of the Lord was around the shepherds. If you don't read it carefully, you think that that scripture is saying the glory of the Lord is around the angel and then later the angels. The glory of the Lord is around the shepherds when this angel appears. So it got me to thinking, what is the glory of the Lord? In Scripture, we hear a lot about the glory of the Lord. Sometimes the glory of the Lord looks like a battle won against all odds. Sometimes the glory of the Lord is revered in the pillar of fire and cloud of God's presence, leading the people out of Egypt and into the wilderness. The glory of the Lord can look like provision, like the manna and the quail that the people had in the wilderness. The glory of the Lord can look like an all-consuming fire, like in the burning bush. The glory of the Lord itself is the power of the Lord. Anytime you have the power of the Lord, you have the glory of the Lord with the power. The shepherds were surrounded by the power of the Lord. This ordinary day was no more. When they were surrounded by the power of God, they were in the presence of God, and ordinary ceased to exist. Maybe this is what terrified them at first, because Scripture does say that they were terrified, and the power of God can be terrifying. Visit the book of Exodus or the book of Joshua or any of a number of books, and you will see God's power and how it can be terrifying to the people. Have you ever had moments where you knew you were in the presence of the Lord and it was terrifying? Or if not terrifying, maybe just slightly unsettling? Maybe you've had an occasion to go against the Lord, and you've had to deal with the consequences that God doles out, and it was unsettling and slightly terrifying. When we know who is in control of our lives, I mean really in control of our lives, maybe that's a little bit terrifying. Maybe it takes our breath away to understand the one who gives breath. The angel told the shepherds not to be afraid. The news, the wisdom, the guidance of the angel was brought, and these shepherds accepted it. They were the first evangelists. These shepherds, these dirty people who cared for sheep, were the first ones to not only visit the Christ child, but to spread the news of the King. Extraordinary happenings. And God did not give them more than they could handle. First was one angel, and then when they could handle the one, then a large group of angels. And when that large group of angels appeared, the first thing they did was praise the Lord and give glory to God. May the scripture says, may glory be given to God in the highest. May peace be given to those who he is pleased with on earth. Glorifying God under any circumstance. The shepherds had to have been God followers because they knew the angels were delivering the message from God. They were praising God with the angels, and then they obeyed God. I think in part this is the very definition of faith. They hurried off and they saw Mary and Joseph and the baby, this baby that was lying in the manger, and they spent a bit of time giving him honor, giving him glory, and then they did not go back to their ordinary lives. They did not forget and say, okay, well, that's it. I'll go back and tend to the sheep. They didn't go back to that as if nothing had happened. They did eventually go back to tending the sheep, but not as if nothing had happened. As the first evangelists, they were the perfect example for us all. Those shepherds after that day expected every day to be extraordinary, because they were in God's presence. So we remember that every day we are in the presence of the Lord, and therefore every day is extraordinary. Don't wake up expecting an ordinary day. Wake up and welcome God in and say, God, because you are with me, this day will be extraordinary. We need to listen to the messengers of God, whoever he has put before us. And then we are obedient and do or stop doing whatever the messenger tells us to do. And we do what the shepherds did next. After the shepherds witnessed the presence of Christ, they left and they told everyone. They reported and gave testimony about what they had seen. They reported what the angels had told them. And then after they gave their testimony, they returned to Christ and gave him more honor and more glory, praising him for all they had seen and heard, filling up on the presence of God. That is what communion is about. We go about our normal day, but we come in here to praise the Lord. We take communion. We take communion to fill up and then go out. We return again and again and again to be in the presence of the Lord. And as we prepare our hearts for communion, we are reminded of the presence of the Lord in this place. But you know what? The presence of the Lord is also in your place. The presence of the Lord is in your home. The presence of the Lord is in your heart. The presence of the Lord is everywhere you go. The shepherds witnessed extraordinary happenings, as do we. They testified to the extraordinary happenings, as we should. They went back to God with the expectation of more extraordinary happenings, as I want us all to do. For they were, as we are, in the presence of the Lord. Their lives had changed forever, just as our lives change forever. As we prepare for communion, let us recognize every day of extraordinary happenings with our lives.
Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy. Do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
A song, a song, high above the tree, with a voice as big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty king, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, do you know what I know? A child, shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Said the king to the people everywhere, listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. The child.
Sacrament of communion, renewal of ourselves. Let those of you who desire to lead a life worthy of Jesus Christ renew your covenant with God. Do you trust in God with all your heart, mind, and strength?
I do.
Will you trust the Holy Spirit to guide your life from this moment forth?
I will.
Will you put Jesus first in your life, trusting nothing else for your salvation?
I will.
Do you reject the bondage of sin, and are you determined to live in the liberty God gives us?
I do.
Are you willing to give an account for the hope which dwells inside you to anyone who asks?
I am, God being my helper.
Are you resolved to serve God that others might know his love?
I am, by God's grace.
Will you strive from this moment to refrain from any attitudes or practices which cheapen the love of God as revealed in Jesus Christ?
I will, God being my strength and helper.
Affirmation of faith. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God uses ordinary people, Joseph and Mary, the shepherds, and you. No special needs, special skills are required, just faith and a desire to be obedient people. No matter your job, no matter your skills, come to the Lord's table. Set everything down. Stay as long as you like. Get rid of the things that say, I can't, and pick up God's belief in you, that you can through his strength and his power. Open your hearts to live your lives not in an ordinary way, but in an extraordinary way for him.
The invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Confession and pardon.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The prayer of consecration.
Lord, we do not come to your table trusting in our own righteousness, but in your many and varied mercies. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but your nature has never changed. You have always been gracious and merciful. Therefore, enable us to truly participate in this sacrament of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we may walk in newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
This slide says, do this in remembrance of me. Do this. This, that we come to his table, do this, remembering Christ. This is called a holy sacrament because it is one of the few times where Christ is present with the people in offering of the bread and the cup, where God is present now. We remember the Lord's presence now. We partake in this holy sacrament, remembering that Christ was, Christ is, and Christ comes again. On the night that Christ was betrayed, he took the bread and he prayed over it. Heavenly Father, creator of all, creator of the bread and the cup, God, we come to you knowing that we are broken and that you are the only one that makes us whole. God, at this time, we thank you for the gift. We thank you for the gift of your Son, the one that prayed for the first time over the meal, the one that gave all after the meal, the one that is present in our lives, in our hearts, and in this place. God, we give you thanks for all things. Amen. And then after he gave thanks, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you and for the many. We remember Christ and all he gave on this day. And then after the meal, he took the cup. And he said, this is my blood that is shed for you and for the many. And every time you take of this bread and you drink of this cup, you do this in remembrance of me until I come again. How often do we think of Christ being in our presence? We get the gift of being with God all the time. As we partake, let us remember the presence of our Lord in our hearts, in this place, all around us. Come to the table. As we partake, I'm going to ask Ron to maybe play some quiet music. And then we will, what we're going to do is just have one aisle at one on each side. Come up and please stay as long as you would like. I would ask that the next aisle not start coming up until you see both sides clearing. Let us take the time and the opportunity to be with our Lord. Yeah, you should. Nope, you're right. Oh, careful. Thank you. Spirit. This is to remind you everything that Christ does for you. Nice job, my sister, Christ's body broken for you. My sister, Christ's body broken for you. My sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. My brother, Christ's body broken for you. My sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. I want us all to remember that you are in the presence of the Lord. You are not ordinary. You are not ordinary, nor is your day, because you are in the presence of the Lord. You are extraordinary, and praise God for his presence in your life each and every day of this week. Go forth, sing the joy that the Lord has for you.